The screen.
Sì, professore. Sì, professore.
Grazie, come al solito. So, good afternoon. We were continuing the yesterday class. We were talking about the Hess law that allow us to consider the heat exchanges in a process independently of the path that we follow from the initial to the final state. And we were at the end of yesterday class, we were talking about some reactants that could be converted in products. And we are asking to ourselves how much is the heat that we exchange if we start from a temperature here, TR for reactants, and we reach final temperature TP for products. So we can consider a special path that with intermediate step, such that we can exploit the heat exchange because of a change of temperature without changing the composition, and the heat that is exchanged because there is some formation or, let's say, dissociation in basic substances of reactants and products. So what we can say, the first step that we can do is to bring these reactants to the temperature, the standard temperature. And with this first step that we call QR, we have just a constant composition, just change of temperature. So we know that in this case, independently of if we are using, if we have introduced or not, the sensible or absolute entropy, we can say that the heat exchange will be related to the change of enthalpy. And if this is the molar enthalpy, this is the final value minus the initial value. And we have to consider, of course, all the species that constitute our reactants. Number of moles and molar values of the enthalpy. Then the second step is to obtain the basic species at, let's say, basic species at T0. So there is, we know that if we go from here to here, along this path, if we go from this species to reactants, we have to spend or extract some formation. These are formation reactions, so that if this is QF of let's say of reactants, that this is the heat of formation. If we are moving in this direction, as we also said yesterday, there will be the heat which is exchanged, which is minus this QFR. And what is this? This QFR is just the heat that we have to spend or extract to get for this formation reaction. And so will be for each mole, we have a given molar enthalpy of formation, and we have a given number of moles, so we have to multiply for the number of moles. And this will be I1 and R, and I delta H Fi 0 molar. This is the the sum of the Edo formations by the number of moles, and of course here I have to consider with minus sign in front because we are dissociating the reaction, the reactant, to their forming molecules, which are, it can be molecules or atoms depending on the kind of species we are talking about. So at this point we can make a fourth step and get products such that we can at the end do a final step where we have just products and we have just to change temperature. So there'll be QP here, and here we have the to spend or extract the heat of formation of products. Once we are here, we are just to change the temperature. So we are similarly for the final step QP, there will be the sum from I bracket that goes from 1 to NP, number of products, and I H I molar, final temperature, at final temperature minus the enthalpy at the standard temperature. And similarly, we have the heat, the overall heat of formation of products, that will be the sum y I1 NP and I delta H F I 0 molar. So what will be the overall heat exchange from reactant at reactant temperature to the product at product temperature? There will be this Q, which is the sum of different contribution except for the formation of reactant that will be taken with the minus sign in front. So we have QR minus QFR plus QFP plus QP. That we can write more extensively as follows, exploiting these expressions and grouping terms under the same summation symbol. So we have one, let's consider first products, and we have Ni, and we see that we have here Hi Tp minus Hi T0 let's put the square brackets plus the other term, which is delta Hf I 0. All this within the summation, and the other summation could be, I prefer to change the sign, as you can see easily, so that I can express everything positively with positive sign with respect to the in a similar form as we have written for the product, because here there is the difference between the enthalpy, I mean here in the QR, you have the difference between the enthalpy at standard temperature minus the enthalpy at reactant temperature. So if I change sign on this term, I have this minus here, minus here, also in QFR, and I can group all minus sign here and obtain an expression which is quite similar to what we have got for the products. So I have HI molar TR minus HI T0. So again, you see similarly, we have the difference of the enthalpy with respect to the standard value. And also the formation enthalpy. So you see here that based on the definition of sensible enthalpy and of the enthalpy of formation and the absolute enthalpy, you can recognize here This is just HSITP. So the sensible enthalpy of the high species at temperature TP, because it's defined exactly as the difference with respect to the value of enthalpy at standard temperature. This is the sensible enthalpy at reactant temperature here. And so you see that here sensible plus the formation enthalpy, this Q will be equal to the sum NP and I H, let's call it absolute enthalpy at a given temperature, TP minus equal 1 and R. And so Ni, absolute enthalpy of the reactants at their temperature. So you see that with the absolute enthalpy, we have a nice simplification of this expression, and we can say that the heat exchange in this, by making explicit different steps that we have introduced for convenience, we can express the overall heat exchange from reactant at this temperature to the product at the product temperature with only considering the difference between the, this is, we can say that this is the absolute enthalpy of the products minus the absolute enthalpy of the reactants. Excuse me. So we, at this point, as we see that the introduction of this absolute enthalpy is quite convenient, we will continue from now on to talk about only absolute enthalpy. So HA is the molar, for instance, is the molar absolute enthalpy. And from in the following of this course, at least, we will consider that H is the same, and we will call it without recording that it's absolute. So we will remove the subscript A, and we just consider as the enthalpy, always the absolute enthalpy. So is this, let's say we have fixed in some way a reference value of enthalpy in a convenient way, and this can be translated also in a convenient reference point for the internal energy. Of course, we recall the definition H is internal energy plus PV, and also the specific mass specific value minus PB, and also this is the mass specific volume. And also the molar expression. And so in any case, we can always express internal energy as a function of the enthalpy. And so we can consider also an absolute internal energy, which is related by the usual and by the definition of enthalpy to the enthalpy itself. So here in general, we are talking about enthalpies, we are talking about internal energies, and we have seen also this reaction where you see that I removed the assumption of perfect gas. So this is, let's say, is a more general discussion that then can be also applied to perfect gases. And so, for instance, you can have also, you can apply this kind of rules related to the Hess law. I recall, and we can also apply this, for instance, to the case where we start from a reactant R1, for instance, which is the given react one. It's a given temperature and solid, and a reaction number two, which is the given temperature in liquid phase. And you have these two reactants, and we should that together make, for instance, for our process, the reactants. And from here we can get the value at temperature a phase standard, so standard phase and temperature, and then we can go to basic species. And finally, to products, formation of products, T0, and products at the final temperature. So this to say that this discussion is even more general. So once we have this important relation that I would like to underline here, we can also, this is the heat exchange if we start from a temperature and arrive at the final temperature. So we start from a reactant temperature and we arrive at the final product temperature. But of course we can also make different assumptions in our problem and solve it in a different way. And one interesting case is the case of adiabatic transformation of our reactants. So that we can consider that we have no heat exchange with surroundings. So adiabatic means that we have no heat exchange. And so Q is equal to zero. But in this case, what will happen that is that if we start from a given mixture of reactants, we will have a final result in terms of products that will be a temperature. If we know which are the products, we can estimate the temperature that we will reach if there is no heat exchange with surroundings. And this can be done considering the same expression with Q equal to zero. So in this case, we have that our sum of NiHi at temperature of products will be equal to the sum and R and P and I H I T R. Right, it's just the same expressions with Q equal to zero. We can equal the absolute entropy of products and the absolute entropy of reactants. So as this is a case where we have reaction and we are interested in reaction where we have heat release, And if we have it released during reaction because of the rearrangement of chemical bonds, it means that we have that if we have this Q equal to zero, this the heat released by the chemical reaction will be inside the gas that is made of products. We can identify this temperature here. We can call it as the adiabatic flame temperature. So it's the adiabatic temperature, that means we can call the adiabatic product temperature, and that for us, for our application, is something related also to combustion, to the existence of flame, so we will call it this TAF as the adiabatic flame temperature. And this is a very important quantity that we will consider as a reference for our study of chemical rockets, because this we will see that is strictly related to the temperature that appears in the C-star. So it represents the, in some way, the energy content that we have because of reactions that can occur starting from a given set of reactants. So it's interesting to see how we can evaluate this adiabatic flame temperature, and at least at this first step, because we will see a further step later. So don't forget that this is the first step for the evaluation of adiabatic flame temperature. And in this case, what we are imagining is that we already know exactly the final composition of the mixer, so which is the which are the products and what is their relative amount. So of course these are absolute entropy, so they are made of a part depending on the temperature and a part which is the heat of formation, which is not depending on temperature. So we have to consider to evaluate this kind of, for instance, if we know the right hand side, that means we know the reactant temperatures, we know which are the reactants, so we know the enthalpy of formation of reactants, so the right hand side is known. And here on the left hand side, if we know the Ni, the number of moles of each species of the product, we know the corresponding enthalpy of formation. We only have to determine the, based on this information, the enthalpy, the sensible enthalpy. We can determine the sensible enthalpy. If we know the sensible enthalpy as a function of temperature, we can calculate the temperature that allow us to make this equation satisfied. So it's useful at this point make some example of values for the enthalpy of formation. And here now I just would like to mention some of the species of interest for us. So for instance, the molecular hydrogen in the gaseous phase, we have that the enthalpy of formation expressed in kilojoule per mole. So be careful when I use mole or kilomoles. For instance, here we have the molar mass and express this in kilogram per kilomole, or gram per mole is the same. And the enthalpy of formation, in this case, mass specific enthalpy of formation, that expressed in megajoule per kilogram. So for the molecular hydrogen in gaseous phase, we have that this value is 0. And the molar mass is 2.02. And of course, this is also 0. If we consider the molecular oxygen, so again, we have seen this is the standard condition of the oxygen. So we have to refer to atoms and how they appear in the standard condition. So for the oxygen, they appear in the molecular phase and the gaseous phase. So this is 0, the enthalpy of formation. And we also know that the molar mass is 32. If we consider now the carbon, we find it in a solid phase, a standard condition, and so it's also 0 here, and the molar mass is 12. Now, let's see something more interesting. Water in gaseous phase. This is not the standard condition for water, which whose standard condition is the liquid phase. And moreover, we have to consider that it's not only liquid phase, but it's also is not a basic element. We have different atoms in its formula, so we have we can consider that we can form this H2O molecule starting from H and O that appear above. So you have here that to form H2O starting from their elements in the standard phase to form a gaseous molecule of water, we need 241.826 kilojoule per mole to be abstracted from our system to keep the to remain at standard temperature, because this is an exothermic reaction. So the molar mass is 18. .015, and of course we can divide this quantity by m and obtain the corresponding value of for the corresponding mass specific value. So just the division of 241 divided by 18, and then we have to adjust the unit of measure. Of course, if we have here kilomole to denominator, here we should consider megajoule per kilomole and then divide by this. So we have 241,826 megajoule per kilomole divided by 18 kilogram per kilomole. We have as a result minus 13.4 23 megajoule per kilogram. Sorry, I said something wrong. Of course, if this is also equivalent to say megajoule per kilomole, and this is equal to gram mole. Okay, so we just this is the same unit measure. I just have to make 241 divided by 18, and then I get 13. Now let's go ahead. Consider CO. That's also an interesting product of our reaction. Standard phase, we can consider the gaseous phase, we'll be interested in it. And this will be here also an exothermic reaction, so with the heat of formation or enthalpy of formation, which is negative, 28.01 and minus 3.946. So this is the, you see that by this reaction we deliver given amount of heat per unit mass that we have obtained. CO2 gaseous minus 3.510, 44.01 minus 8.941. The molecular nitrogen is also in its standard phase and its single atom that makes this molecule, single kind of atoms. So this will be again 28.01 and it's zero. And then other species would be NH3, ammonia, or OH. Or RP1, which is a propellant, a synthesizing in liquid phase, as we usually store, or CH4, another propellant. And here we can list different values. So we have here minus 45.94, 57.278, minus 24.717, minus 74.6. These are just examples. And what you can notice is that if you look to OH, the one I'm writing now, 17.01 is molar mass, but you see that here we have a positive enthalpy of formation. That means that this formation reaction is an endothermic one. So we have to provide energy to get OH starting from O2 and H2. So making the now just the division, you have the values of the, I leave to you these values that you just obtained by dividing the first by the second column. So how we exploit these values? In general, we in this reaction where we change the number of, let's say, we change the species that we are we have before and after reaction. We of course what we don't change is the number of atoms. And so, for instance, if we consider H2. Plus 1/2 O2, that gives H2O. This can be read in different ways, but the correct way is to say I have 1 mole of H2 plus 1/2 mole of O2 gives 1 mole of H2O. And of course, if you go at atomic level, you cannot consider 1/2 atom or 1/2 molecule here, if you do molecular level. 1/2 molecule is not meaning, but of course, if you consider at molar level, you have a lot of molecules, Avogadro number of molecules, making 1 mole of each species, and so you can talk, you can write this in, also in this way. If we consider the balance of atoms from reactant two products, this must be, of course, they must be the same. So I have 2 atoms of hydrogen on the left-hand side and also 1 atom of oxygen on the left-hand side. And these values are equal to what we have on the right-hand side. So if this is only a way of discussing about quantity of reactants and quantity of products, because we write this in this way and we intend 1 mole of H2 alpha mole of O2 and 1 mole of H2O. So you see that here we have 1.5 moles overall, and here the products we have just 1 mole. So if we consider our NIs, which are this one, we can say that if I consider X4, H2, it will be the number of moles of H2 or the overall number of moles. So here we have 1 over 1.5 or 2/3. And for O2, we have half mole over 1.5 moles of reactants. And so the molar fraction will be 1/3. So you see 2/3 plus 1/3 gives the overall number of moles and molar fraction in this case. For products in this case, it's actually trivial because we have 1 mole of H2O and 1 mole overall. So also the mass fraction of H2O is 1. We can, in general, also consider the older species, so that you see, you recall that we have here I equal 1 to nR or to nP. We can consider n in general in our summation symbol, and we will consider that here among the reactants we have that X H2O is 0, and here among the products we have X H2 equal to XO2 equal to 0. In terms of the same reaction can be seen also in terms of masses. So you see that here we have 1 mole of molecular hydrogen, and as the molar mass we can consider 1 kilomole, so we consider it's the same, we consider 1 kilomole of H2, 1 alpha kilomole of O2, and 1 kilomole of H2O. So 1 kilomole of H2 weighs as mass, sorry, of 2 kilograms. So we have 2 kilograms of H2 plus alpha kilomole of O2. So O2, you see here, has a molar mass of 32 kilograms per kilomole. So alpha kilomole will have a mass of 16 kilograms. And this will yield as the molar mass of H2O is 18, and so we have that result is 18 kilograms in just one kilomole that we have on the right hand side, 18 kilograms of H2O. So you see that, for instance, on the if you consider the moles we have, that we have 1.5 moles of reactants and 1 mole of products. On the other hand, you see here that together they make 18 kilograms of reactants, and we have 18 kilograms of products. And this is, of course, consistent with the fact that we are conserving the mass of our atoms. And we can, at this point, once we see these reactions in terms of masses, you can also write the corresponding mass fractions. Corresponding mass fractions. And for instance, here we have that among the reactants, the mass fraction of H2 is 2 kilograms over 18 kilograms. Whereas the mass fraction of O2 is 16 over 18 overall kilograms. So 8 over 9. And here, for the products, here again is trivial because we have YH2O will be 18 kilograms over 18 kilograms, it's just one. So you see that because of the quite different molar mass of each species, we can have that mass fractions are quite different than molar fractions. So let's move forward and consider now an evaluation of our belly flame temperature. Yes, there is also a further comment that I have to do. You see here what we have written in this expression. But also in this one we are making reference to, which is the more general one, where we have also some heat exchange. So this is the, these are joules. So this is energy. And this can be expressed in terms of more specific values, so molar values and the number of moles, but also in terms of mass values. So we should write the same expression, write it in terms of masses, the same Q is equal also to summing the products with their masses. And with corresponding enthalpy. Minus so this is something that becomes interesting at the moment where you are considering the adiabatic flame temperature. So or in general what you can consider is that if you have these two expressions, an important aspect is that you have that the overall mass of the products and reactants is the same, but the overall number of moles is not the same. So if in the first equation I can divide by M, which is the sum of MI, of reactants, and it's also equal to the sum of the MI of products, but here we have that NR, which is equal to sum I1 NR and I is different from NP in general. So in the first case, we can divide everything by M, and I have a Q over M, which is equal to the sum of YH so that I have a general expression which is not depending on the amount of reactants and products that I have. Whereas we cannot write a similar expression for the moles. I should consider here that Q is equal to the number of moles of product overall by the sum of Xi Hi molar RTP minus NR and the sum Xi Hi molar TR. So let's stop 10 minutes as usual, and we will soon resume.
May I ask a question?
Of course.
When we talk about the heat of formation of gases we've seen before, do we take into account the state of the, for example, the water vapor?
Yeah.
Has the same heat of formation being liquid or gas? No,
of course, you have to spend a different amount of energy to get it. You have also the change of phase, the energy related to the change of phase. So you will find a different value if you consider H2O liquid.
So we may, in this term, we made also, yes, the change of state, but we don't take into account the change of temperature, just the phase and the formation.
Let's say this, you have, this is the amount of entropy or the heat that you have to, that you obtain by considering at the standard temperature, the formation of gaseous H2O starting from H2 and O2. If you form at the same temperature the liquid phase water, you'll have a different amount of energy spent because there is, of course, the difference. You could make a step and go from the H2O2 to H2O gaseous, and then you make a further step to liquefy it. And this further step will also consider the heat of liquefaction that should be summed to this value. So you have a different value. But this heat of formation are all relative to the what happens at standard temperature and pressure.
Okay, understood. Thank you very much.
Welcome. So let's continue. And following the question raised during the break, the enthalpy of formation of liquid water will be more negative than the gaseous water. So we have that delta HF H2O liquid is minus 285.82 kilojoule per mole. So you see that it's more negative, and in fact, if you pass from, if your final result is H2O, if you make this reaction, and you have to consider the heat of this reaction, so you have minus 241 minus 285, you see that you have a positive value that tell you that you are giving, you are supplying energy from outside. This will be an endothermic reaction, so you have to spend energy to get gaseous water starting from liquid water. Considering what we were talking about before, you see that the expression with respect to the mass seems to be more convenient because we have the same mass before and after the reaction. And this is even more evident if you are considering the case with Q equal to zero, where we have no additional terms besides the mass fractions and specific enthalpies. So in general, if we write the heat, which is exchanged per unit mass in our reaction of formation of gaseous water, we have that Q, if this is capital Q over M, will be obtained as, we have to make reference to this expression, where we have that reactants are H2 and O2, with 1 and 1/2 mole, or 1/9 and 8/9 mass fraction, and you have as the product H2O. So in general, what we have to write here, we have to write the differences of sensible enthalpies between reactant and products, and or products and reactants, and also of the enthalpy of formation. So you have to write here, let's start with the enthalpy of formation, and we have that Y. For the H2O, we have Y is equal to 1 among the products. Then we have also the sensible enthalpy of H2O at our temperature we are interested in, and then we have to subtract the terms relevant to products. And here, you know, you should have minus 1/9 delta HF H2 zero minus 8/9 delta HF O2 zero minus 1/9 HS H2 at the temperature that we are considering. If you are considering given a generic temperature for this reaction, we write TP and TR, that will be more general, and 8/9 HS O2 at temperature TR. And well, you see here that these two terms will be zero. And so you can obtain a simplified expression, especially if you are considering a perfect gas. So under the assumption of perfect calorically perfect gas, it means that you have here that you are sensible. Enthalpy can be expressed in terms of the constant specific heat and the difference with respect to the standard temperature. So you have delta HF H2O 0 plus Cp H2O Tp minus T0 T standard. And similarly, 1/9 Cp H2 Tr minus T standard. And finally, also for the O2. So a special case is the one that we can obtain consider the same temperature for reactant and products. And then we'll go back to the adiabatic flame temperature. So if I consider now the Tp equal to Tr equal to a given temperature, we can express, if we are close to the standard temperature, so that we can assume that the value that we know, for instance, T0 of Cp for different species, and we assume these values to make our evaluation of the heat, we can assume that what we know is, we don't know the Cp, but we know the molar mass of species and the gamma. So gamma H2O is equal to 1.33, gamma O2 is equal to 1.4, gamma H2 is 1.4. As to course, at low temperature for the atomic molecules, the last two value. And we can express our Cp as gamma R over gamma minus 1. So to work with mass specific value, and our R, of course, is the universal gas constant divided by the molar mass. So we have all the information we need to evaluate our R, that is for the H2, can be evaluated approximately as 8314, which is the universal gas constant without numbers further significant digits. So it will be 4157 Joule kilogram Kelvin. RO2 is 260, and R H2O is equal to 462. So we can, as a consequence, evaluate our Cp, because we have gamma, we have R at this point. H2 will be 14,550 J/kg Kelvin. CpO2 will be 910, and finally CpH2O will be 1,848 J/kg Kelvin. So if we have now, if you go back to your expression here, you see that we have now the Cp, the generic temperature, the standard temperature is known. So if you were like to express this Q as a function of temperature, you can see that we still need the value of delta FH2O that we already, but we have this on the list above, it's -13.4 MJ/kg. So putting everything together, we have that Q is equal to -13.4, let's write it in the international system, so it's 10 to the 6, because we had megajoule, and so here we have 1848, which is CpH2O, minus we have 8 over 9 for the oxygen as reactant, so we have the minus sign, by the Cp, which is 910, and -1/9 by 14,550 for the hydrogen. So these are the terms that multiply. Here we have T minus T0, which is multiplied by the Cp of H2O -1/9 of CpH2 -8/9 of CpO2. So this is reported here, that will be multiplied by T minus T0. So we have this expression. And if I didn't make error, should be this relation in joule per kilogram. So you see that we can express in this way the heat released by this reaction as a function of the temperature. In particular, we have that, of course, this is the formation reaction. So the formation reaction at the standard temperature will be, of course, this one, the heat of formation. But if you change temperature, there will be a difference that comes from this term. So if we consider, in at least in a range of temperature not too far from the standard temperature, and we'd like to evaluate the heat of formation of water vapor, we can use this expression. And we see that this heat of reaction doesn't change much with temperature, unless you consider, at least as far as you consider, let's say, small differences of temperature. On the other hand, you see that this actually change, if you consider a large difference, or you have to consider a large difference of temperature to make this value change. And in fact, if we are, we move in the other direction, so to evaluate the final temperature, starting from reactants and getting considering the adiabatic process, we should apply the same equation, but with Q equal to zero. And in this case, we should consider different temperature for reactants and products. like this. Minus. So we can, so this would be equal to zero. And a particular case is the one that we can consider if reactants are at standard condition. In this case, you see that we cancel these terms, and we see that we have that minus delta HF H2O zero is equal to CP TP minus T zero. Of course, here actually we should consider this is our adiabatic frame temperature by definition. And so this temperature will be expressed in terms of the heat of formation and the specific heat. This is quite simple if we use, of course, the mass specific values. Or actually, here also the molar specific values work because we have no contribution from reactants. But in general, it's more convenient using the mass specific value. And you can make the you can consider here our standard temperature of 208.15 and here minus 13.4 and here the value that we have just evaluated, which is 462 joule kilogram Kelvin. We put things together and we obtain something like more or less 7400 Kelvin. So it looks strange, perhaps for if we have an idea of what will be the heat released by this reaction, because we expect something a lower temperature than this value here. So actually the result that we are obtaining here is that the final temperature that we have, if we start with reactants and we don't exchange it with surroundings, we have as a result products at this temperature. But this is not the actual value. And why? Because we, in the real case, we have if we put together H2 and O2 standard condition in gaseous phase, at the end we will get something like temperature something, let's say something less of 4000 Kelvin. And the reason of because we don't get this value are mainly two. The first one is that we are assuming here a calorically perfect gas, and if we move from 300 to 7000 Kelvin, the specific heat will not remain constant. It will be a huge change of the CP that, for instance, if you already consider between 300 and 4000, which is we know that we have we will reach this value at the end, the specific heat can change of factor 2, so making a huge difference. And the second reason is that we are assuming that if we put together H2 and O2, we obtain H2O. But this is not always the case. You can have some other products that make the final mixture, especially because we are reaching very high temperature where also other reactions have to be taken into account, and possibly they are endothermic reaction of dissociation, as for instance the formation of OH starting from H2O, and we have seen in the list of different species that OH is positive heat of reaction, heat of formation, sorry, and this means that overall this will make the final temperature lower. So the first step that we have to consider is the one related to the CP, specific heat, which is not constant. So, of course, we should consider at least some average value of CP. And if we consider, for instance, that at temperature of 4000, we have that gamma is no longer 1.33 for the water, but it's 1.16. It results that our CP is quite different of the 460 value that you have got at 300 Kelvin. So if we consider this CP rather than the one that you have considered before, so if we say we can make an iteration, let's assume that we are going to make an iterative process. We have 300, 7500, and so we say we take an average value, let's consider 4000. And so if we take this, we obtain a final temperature which has usual expression of Kelvin. That means that you should consider an average value which is something here, so at a lower temperature, and you can go forward. But actually, of course, the behavior, the dependency of CP on temperature is not linear. And so this will be, in general, an approximation, especially if you are considering value range of temperature going from a few hundred Kelvin to several thousand Kelvin. You have that CP will change more or less in this way with temperature. And we started from the, it was not 400, it was 1800 at 300 Kelvin. And for instance, this would be 3500. And for instance, I have here 4000. Of course, the drawing I made is more or less linear, but actually, it's not a linear behavior. Anyway. You should consider that we can make a correct evaluation if we know this dependence of CP on temperature. And actually, what we are doing is, in this case, more correctly, if we go back to the correct assumption of of thermally perfect gas you have here in this expression, you should get greater than Cp, H2O, Tp minus T0 should be the just the sensible enthalpy of water at this temperature. So actually we have that 0 is equal to delta HF at H2O 0 plus, so HS H2O at our temperature. So we have just to see where the absolute, at which temperature the absolute enthalpy of water is zero, and or where the absolute, the sensible enthalpy is equal to the enthalpy of formation change of sign. And we can we have actually there are polynomial interpolation of experimental data or of statistical mechanics solutions that allow us to see the behavior of Cp as a function of temperature, and this can be also tabulated. So for instance, I'm now showing you a table. Yes, H2O. You see here, and at this moment, what we are talking about is the enthalpy of formation, and you see the sensible enthalpy and the absolute enthalpy as a function of temperature. These are all molar values, but the in this case, as I said before, we have just the water as the product, so you don't make errors. You can just see where, to which temperature. You see temperature is increasing here on the left. We have that the last column becomes zero. You see that it happens here between 4,900 Kelvin and 5,000 Kelvin. And you see that here the sensible enthalpy becomes larger than the enthalpy of formation change of sign. So at this point, we have our zero, and we can understand from this table that the temperature will be between these two quantities, and we can interpolate here linearly, and we obtain that more because we have here the Cp within this range is not changing much. So we can make correctly a linear interpolation, and we obtain that the result will be 4,920 Kelvin. Of course, we can make this table for H2O, but also, for instance, you have the same table for CO2 and for other quantities, and we will use this table in some exercise later. Let's go back to our So we see from this that we have that our temperature is about this one. So this is not sufficient, as I mentioned before, because when you are considering, because we are considering here that all H2 and O2 is becoming H2O. And this is not always the case because these are high temperature, and at this temperature we have the presence of other product of reaction. And the question is at this point, what is the, if we consider some reactant that give us that yield an exothermic reaction overall that allow us to have high temperature products, that is what we are aiming to consider for our rockets, is the question is, what will be the correct composition of the mixture resulting from this reaction? And so the next step is to determine this composition. We, to do that, we make some further step, and we can consider that in general, we have a reaction that we can write in this way. Let's say these are reactant and products. So we have our reactants and products. We generalize the action equation in this way, and this our example was this one, where these are the products and these are the reactants, of course. So in general, we should consider that we have some stoichiometric coefficients, this nu, that tell us about the proportion of reactants and products that we have in our reaction. So in our case, we have a single product. In general, we have more than one. So if we have more than one, we have to establish which will be the products. In general, also this is a simplification, because actually what happens is that reactions are going forward and backward. So if we have the formation of some product, we have also the formation of reactants starting from the products in general, very general fashion. So we should also consider that the real reactions occur among molecules through collisions. And so you have, let's say, elementary steps that occur that altogether make a final general mechanism of reaction. But if I talk about this, I'm thinking of the process that leads from reactant to products. So there will be reactions with their own kinetics that needs time to reach a final product. And if we have enough time, the forward and backward reaction with balance, and at the end composition will no longer change. So in general, you have a reaction that is collision among molecules that would, from reactants, will generate a product, and as a final result, if we have enough time, we don't see what happens in time, but we see what will be some equilibrium condition that is reached after a given amount of time. So at the end of the process, in the equilibrium condition, it means that composition is no longer changing because we have a balance of backward and forward reactions. And we should identify now, as we have done also for the processes that start with the final initial condition and reach a final condition, we don't care about the path that we follow to reach this final condition at the same In the same way, we would like to identify what will be this final equilibrium condition independently of the path we follow to reach this equilibrium. And so we can exploit to do that the second law of thermodynamics, and to our goal, our final goal is to understand how much of the possible products that we can generate. For instance, if I consider H2 and O2 in any ratio, in general, they can yield different kind of products like H2O for sure, but also OH, H, O, or some, let's say, also some of the, sorry, this is not this plus, sorry, comma, also some of the reactants themselves. So we start from this set of reactants and we end with this set, for instance, then you can make it even more complex, like H2O2 or I don't know what, something like O2H and so on, different species. But each of them has its own properties, and we'll let know which will be the amount of each possible species starting from given reactants, and in a certain sense, given atoms available. So to do that, we exploit, as I mentioned, the second law of thermodynamics, recalling that if we write here, we write the Q is equal to dE plus PdV. This is the first principle, and the second principle says that the Q reversible process will be equal to TdS. But we also have seen that in the real processes, our change of entropy will be greater than the heat exchanged, because we have also the irreversible processes. So in general, we write that TdS will be equal to dQ plus some irreversible change, irreversible increase of entropy. So we can exploit this inequality, or equality here, and to make evident irreversible processes. The equilibrium condition is the one where we obtain the maximum entropy. So there will be a point where we no longer have changes of the entropy. And so we can explore this concept to write a convenient expression that allows us to evaluate the equilibrium composition. So to do that, we should consider different ways of expressing the energy. In fact, our delta Q can be expressed, as I mentioned here, as dE plus PdV, but also in terms of enthalpy. And we can add further ways of expressing the energy through the Helmholtz free energy F, which is E minus TS, or the Gibbs free energy, which is H minus TS. And this is convenient because you will see in a moment that we, with this expression with g, we have a particularly interesting expression in case we are considering a constant pressure, constant temperature process. So with this relation, this delta Q, which is something less of our change of entropy, will be expressed in terms of F or G. And you can see here that we have this TDS here and here and here that can be properly simplified, and you can also say write this with the equal sign and adding, let's do it this way. This is also equal to delta Q plus the irreversible process generated entropy. So this, the equal sign is valid when we have this red term here. The inequality is without this TDS irreversible. So consider the equality, we can simplify our TDS in the last two equations. And for instance, we have that 0 is equal to dg plus sdt minus VdP plus TdS irreversible. Of course, this quantity is greater than zero, according to the fact that this should be greater than that TdS should be greater than dq. It means that TdS irreversible should be greater than zero. And well, from here, you see that a condition that should be satisfied is that for an isothermal and isobaric process, so if T is constant, P is constant, it follows that dG is equal to minus TdS irreversible and should be less than zero. So of course, the final comment for today is that exactly like H and E, we can express also G for a mixture as the sum of Mi, Gi, and also as the sum of Ni, molar Gi. And of course, also our specific Gibbs free energy, Gi, will be H minus T S, according to the definition that we have got here, this one. So at this point, we can express our G. As a function in general of temperature, pressure, and let's say number of particles of each species. And the next step will be how to exploit the second law of thermodynamics to express the unknown number of species, number, let's say, mass fractions or number of each species that allow us to consider an equilibrium condition. And this will be discussed in the next class. That will be, of course, the next Wednesday. That is the 7th. At usual time. So we will have a break for Easter holidays, and we will see. I still don't know if on 7th there will be blended classes with also someone in presence or not. Probably, I don't know if they will start with this on Wednesday or on the next Monday. So, of course, you will be informed, and in case we are in presence, at least partially in presence, we, of course, you can, I think you have to reserve and to book your presence according to the Prodigy system as done before. And we can stop here for today.
Arrivederci.
Arrivederci.
Arrivederci. Arrivederci.